Epiphany. What is an epiphany? The dictionary defines it as a sudden manifestation of the essence or meaning of something, a comprehension or perception of reality by means of a sudden intuitive realization. Here is the story of an epiphany. It was Shavuos, and we were in Jerusalem. We'd gone to lunch to a former leader of a major diaspora community. Together there was an Israeli diplomat, as well as one of the leading figures in the Canadian Jewish community. And the conference turned, remember this is May 2001, to the forthcoming and now notorious United Nations conference against racism in Durban. It was not due to take place until August, but already we knew that it and the parallel gathering of NGOs was going to turn into a major assault on Israel's legitimacy. And the diplomat, seeing that we were all very depressed at this prospect, said, in order to cheer us up, that it was ever thus. Because we are, in that phrase from this coming week's parasha, Am Levadad Yishkon, the people that dwells alone. It comes from Bil'am, if you remember, hired to curse the Jewish people, and instead of doing that, blessed them and said in the following words, how can I curse whom God has not cursed? How shall I defy whom the Lord has not defied? From the top of rocks I see him, and from in the hills I behold him. It is an Am Levadad Yishkon, a people that dwells alone, not reckoned among the nations. And hearing those words, in that context, I had my epiphany, my sudden explosion of light, and I suddenly saw how dangerous this phrase was to Jewish self-definition. The trouble is that if you define yourself as a people that dwells alone, you are likely to find yourself alone. And that is not a safe place to be. Are you sure, I said to the diplomat, that this is a blessing? Maybe it was a curse. Don't forget who said it. Bil'am, who was not exactly a friend of the Jewish people. He's one of the people mentioned in the Mishnah as one of the four commoners who doesn't have a share in the world to come. We know from the Torah itself that having failed to curse the Israelites, he eventually did them great harm a different way. And remember, I said, what the Talmud says about Bil'am. It says in the Gemara in Sanhedrin that Kulam chazru liklala, all the blessings that Bil'am blessed the people with all turned into curses, with one exception, how goodly are your tents, O Jacob, the phrase that refers to shuls and houses of study. But other than that, the rabbis were suggesting that everything Bil'am said was ambiguous, so that his words could be interpreted as a blessing, but actually meant as a curse. Besides which, levadad, levad, being alone, is that good or bad in Judaism? There is a verse, the first time the words not good appear in the Torah, in which it says, the Lord God said, lo tov heyot ha'adam levado. It's not good for man to be alone. What is more, about a leper, the Torah says they must live alone. Badad yeshev mechutz lemachaneh moshavo. He is bound to live outside the camp. And most famously, the word levadad appears in the opening verse of the book of Echa of Lamentations. Echa yashva vadad ha'ir rabatiyam. How lonely, how deserted is the city that was once full of people. So, except when the word alone appears in connection with God, almost always, being alone in Tanakh, in the Jewish Bible, is rarely a blessing. It is instead a curse. And I suddenly realized that the diplomat trying to give us comfort was actually saying something that is very dangerous. It is obvious and natural to many people after the rise of anti-Semitism after the Holocaust, after the way Jews were treated in Europe in the 19th and 20th centuries, to say that we are the people destined to be alone in the world. But that is not how the commentators understood the phrase. Am Levadad Yishkon, says Rashi, means that Jews are indestructible. According to Ibn Ezra, it means that they don't assimilate. Ramban says they maintain their own integrity. It doesn't mean that they're destined to be isolated without allies or friends. Nobody says this before the modern age. That is not a destiny, let alone is it an identity. To be a Jew is to be loved by God. It is not to be hated by Gentiles. Our ancestors were called on to be Mamlechet Kohanim v'Goy Kadosh, a holy nation, kingdom of priests. The word Kadosh means set apart. But to be set apart is one thing, to be alone is another. Leaders are set apart, but they aren't alone. If they were alone, they couldn't lead. They'd have nobody to lead. Artists, musicians, athletes, tennis players, given Wimbledon, they live apart, they practice, they're preparing for a big performance, but they're not alone. When they are apart, they're doing so for a reason. It allows them to focus their energies, to hone and refine their skills. But being apart is not an existential condition, an inevitable isolation. There is no suggestion in the Torah that Jews are destined to live alone. God says to Abraham, through you all the families of the earth will be blessed. Abraham was different from his neighbors, but he prayed for them. He fought battles on their behalf. He was different, but he wasn't alone. For some time now, and that Durban conference was really one of the earliest signs of it, the Jewish people, Israel, diaspora, Jewry, has faced international isolation. Shechita is under attack in Holland. Brit Milah is under attack in San Francisco. Battles we thought we had won for freedom as Jews, whether individually in the diaspora or collectively and nationally in the state of Israel, we are discovering we're going to have to fight all over again. But those fights are important fights. They're good fights, fights whose outcome will affect more than Jews, because the truth is, in ancient times, Israel was a small nation surrounded by large empires. In the Middle Ages, they were the most conspicuous minority in Christian Europe. Today, in the Middle East, Israel is the country, the most conspicuous country that is not Muslim. Jews are the archetypal other. We don't fit into the dominant paradigm, the majority faith, the prevailing culture. And that is what we're there for, not just for ourselves, but for humanity, to remind ourselves that there is such a thing as the dignity of dissent. That's what we do in life. We challenge, we argue, we stand out against the crowd, we go against the trend. We are apart, but we are not destined to be alone. It is no accident that the story of Avram, what anyone know what comes before the story of Avram in the Torah? Immediately prior to that is the story of the Tower of Babel. You remember how the Tower of Babel begins? The whole world was a shared language, and they all said the same things. And the Netziv, Naftali Tzvi Yehuda Berlin, said, if everyone thinks the same thing and there's no dissent, that is not a free society. So we are there to be different for the sake of everyone's right to be different. We fight for the right to be, whether as a nation in its historic land or as a religious group in the diaspora, we fight for the right to be free to live as Jews, not just for our sake, but for the sake of every other minority in the world, every other small people surrounded by empires, everyone who seeks the right to challenge the prevailing culture or the dominant faith. That is why we are there. So, as we prepare ourselves for the next battle in the fight for freedom, which we still have to fight again, it is vitally important to know, number one, we're not doing this just for ourselves alone, and number two, to know that we are not destined to be without friends or allies. We will have friends, we will have good allies, if we go out and win them. But if we think it is our destiny to be alone, we'll probably land up alone. That is a self-fulfilling prophecy. So, guys, don't forget, it's lonely being alone. It is not our destiny. It is not a blessing. It was a curse by somebody who didn't think the very best of us. Never believe that it is our destiny to be alone. Let us go out and make friends, and we will find them. Shabbat Shalom.